What I have here is an Optimus DCT-2000 digital compact cassette deck, better known as DCC. This is not going to be a full review of this machine and of the DCC format, not only because Techmoan already did a very good video about DCCs, but also because I'm not sure if I'll be able to get this machine working. This was a thrift store find. I think I paid 20 bucks for it. And when I first got it, I didn't have any DCC tapes, but these can play regular analog cassettes. So I tried it with a regular tape, and it goes through all the motions. This is a tray loading machine, so you kind of load it like a CD. And it shows analog. We can hit play. And it acts like it's playing, but there's no audio coming out. And you can see there's nothing on the meters. Only thing I can hear is that when I switch on Dolby, I can hear the reduction and hiss. So I know the audio circuitry is working at least somewhat, but somehow it's not getting the audio from the tape. I don't know if it has a bad head or some kind of fault in the electronics. But I figured it was worth a shot trying to play a digital tape to see if at least that would work, because I know some of these fail in a certain way where you can only play digital tapes or you can only play analog tapes, so maybe this has something going on like that. Because these DCC decks are known for problems, they're from the early 90s when a lot of electronics had bad surface mount capacitors in them. And this may be a cause of this unit's problems, but I figured I would get a DCC tape to test it out with. And I just got the cheapest one I could find on eBay. And I didn't know at the time I bid on it that it's still sealed in the original packaging. So I'm going to be opening this for the first time since 1993. Although I think the DCC version of this album was released in 1994. So here we go, opening up a brand new DCC tape for the first time. Alright, these things slide out of the side. Techmoan did a very good overview of the case design of these and how they differ from regular cassettes. So here is the DCC cassette. It's an album by John Hyatt called Perfectly Good Guitar on A&M. And it has a shutter to protect the tape. You can just about see the leader in there. Let's see if it at least recognizes it as a digital tape. It says check tape. I don't know if that's telling me to check the tape or if it's saying that it's checking the tape. It found the track. Is it going to play? Got to connect an audio output of this if it's going to work. It's counting up. I mean, it recognized it as digital. Maybe I have to fast forward. Let's see. Should be past the leader by now. I don't know. I don't see anything on the meters. Input select digital. Auto ID. There's all kinds of controls here for the ID markers. Like, I think you can put artist and title on these. Right, erase. Program text. No, it's not showing any of the text, and it would have been playing by now. So that's unfortunate. Let's try the other side. I mean, the whole mechanism is working. Obviously, the belts are good. But it's just not getting anything. So, fortunately, I think this deck is a lost cause unless, I don't know, somehow I can fix it. I know these use a special type of head, so it's not like you can just order an ordinary cassette head and install it like you can with a regular cassette deck when the heads on those go bad. And I doubt there are any spare heads for DCC players. So, at least they didn't eat the tape. Try one more time, just in case. This is check tape. Did you hear that squealing? Let me turn off my music. And it stopped. That was funny. It's making a squealing sound. Let's see if it does that for regular tape. Wait a minute. We're getting something on the meters. I gotta connect an audio source to this so you can hear it. Well, unfortunately, that was a false alarm. When the meters go up and down, all I hear through the headphones are just some crackling noises. So, it's not actually playing the audio. I think it's just picking up some residual noise. Like when I move the Dolby switches, you can see a little bit of a spike on the meter. That's funny. Percussive maintenance and it picks up audio. I don't know, there could be a bad solder joint. Of just tapping on it makes some meters go up and down. Let's see what happens if I do that while I'm just playing a DCC tape. And by the way, the tape in these is like pitch black. It looks like a metal tape. See that? I'm kind of curious what this would sound like if I took the tape out of this and re-spooled it onto a regular cassette and played it in a standard analog cassette deck, but I don't want to ruin the only DCC tape I have. If I can find one of these where the tape has gotten chewed up or broken and it's unplayable, then I would take it apart and do that, but not on a good one. I don't want to ruin something that's kind of scarce, even though apparently you can still find these brand new sealed in the original packaging. Oh, my PC waked up. See, it doesn't do that in digital. It doesn't show anything on the meter when I slam on it. So, this has been my rather pointless adventure of wasting, I don't know, $13 or whatever I paid on this DCC just to see if it would work in this machine. Maybe one day I'll get a working machine, but for now, unfortunately, this one is not working. See, it shows some response on the meter, but it's not playing. It's a nice mechanism. I would have liked to use it if it was working. I like the controls. They're nice and fast. But unfortunately, not working. I know some of you will want to see the inside, so here it is. And it has these two plug-in cards. And if you're thinking these are subject to oxidation on the contacts, and maybe that was the cause of the problem, well, I already tried unplugging and replugging them several times to clean the contacts, and that has not fixed the problem. Normally they're held in place with these retaining clips. And those connectors almost look like Apple II expansion slot connectors. Wonder if they even have the same amount of pins. But, so these are not the problem, or at least not the connections. See these surface mount capacitors, those are known for problems on electronics from the early to mid 90s, such as this. So that could be the problem with this one. And believe it or not, this was actually made in the USA, or at least part of it. It says PCB made in Taiwan, power supply assembled in USA by Tandy Corporation, even though this was designed by Philips. And there's the mechanism. Put in a tape and hit play. And there it starts playing. And I can get some response on the meters by, you know, tapping around on the head and the various parts here, but I never can get it to start playing audio properly. And this is one of those flip head mechanisms for doing the second side. If I stop the tape, oh, it reverses direction, okay. This main board also has a Tandy copyright on it, dated 1992. Those are some of the main chips there. I actually have circuitry on both sides of these plug-in cards. Here's what's on the back: analog inputs and outputs, optical inputs and outputs, coaxial inputs and outputs. And it says, custom manufactured in USA for Radio Shack, Fort Worth, Texas. Catalog number 14-675, digital compact cassette tape deck by Optimus. Serial number is only 3,775. Wonder how many of these actually made. Probably not very many. And hiding under these wires is a date code, November 11th, 1992. So considering that this model didn't even appear in the Radio Shack catalog until 1994, which would have been released in the fall of 1993, this is one of the very early production models.
All first-generation DCC players, like the Philips, Marantz, and Optimus, suffer from leaking SMD capacitors because of the well-documented capacitor plague. First signs of failing capacitors are weakening output on either the left or right channel, audio dropouts, or no audio at all.
I saw a video by Dr. DCC in which he mentions that a lot of the problems with these first-generation DCC decks are caused due to failing surface mount electrolytic capacitors, which over time leak out their electrolyte and fail, and the only real way to fix it is to replace them. But I'm going to try the quick fix that Techmoan used to get his Macintosh Classic working again, and that is just to remove these boards and wash them to remove the electrolyte residue from the leaking capacitors, and sometimes that alone might be enough to get it working again temporarily. Now, mostly these surface mount electrolytic capacitors are on these two plug-in cards, which are super easy to remove on this. You just unplug them. Unfortunately, there are some also on this other little board way the heck in there, which is probably where the signals come directly off the tape head. You don't see any on this side, but I was able to look through the vents underneath. And on the other side of that little circuit board, there are more of those surface mount electrolytic capacitors, which are likely to be failing and leaking and causing problems. Now, hopefully, removing this whole mechanism to get at that will be as simple as taking out these four screws. There are two on each side there. and hopefully this whole mechanism will lift out, so I'll see if that's the case. Indeed, I only needed to take out those four screws to remove the whole mechanism. Now I just have a bunch of cables to disconnect, and I'm color coding them to make sure I put them back in the right place, which is always an important thing to do. So let me just unplug all this and get this thing out of here. Here's that circuit board I was talking about. There's that ribbon cable coming directly off the tape head, and there's a whole bunch of those capacitors. So I'm going to remove this circuit board. So there are the three circuit boards with those failing surface mount electrolytic capacitors, which will eventually need to be replaced, but I'll try a quick fix of soaking them in some soapy water to clean off the electrolyte from the circuit boards and see if that works. Plop, plop, fizz. And while we're waiting for that, here's a Stereo Review magazine from January 1997. And they published a letter from David D. Rogers of Northridge, California, who gave a passionate defense of DCC, even though it had just recently been discontinued. He listed all the companies that were still selling DCC decks and tapes and pre-recorded cassettes, and he mentioned this internet mailing list he founded, and it mentions the website. I'll have to look that up on archive.org to see how long that lasted. He admitted at the end, with the coming of superior DVD audio, which itself didn't really catch on, and the improved sonics of minidisc, it's clear that DCC is not the recording medium of the future, but the format has a lot of benefits for those who want a durable, inexpensive digital recording medium today. For less than half the cost of a DAT deck, you can buy a DCC deck and enjoy recordings that are sonically indistinguishable from a CD with money left over for essentials like food and blank tapes. And the editors of the magazine write, "Thanks for the additional information, but as far as Philips DCC equipment goes, the company told us that once decks already in the retail pipeline are gone, there won't be any more." And that was probably written in late 1996, whenever this magazine was being assembled. So that was really the end of DCC, late 1996, early 1997. And this is one of the few mentions of anything relating to vinyl records when Shure had introduced the new phono cartridge, the V15 VXMR. Otherwise, there's basically no mention of anything relating to records and turntables in the entire magazine, which is typical for the era. And here, they're mentioning Sony was making a big second push on minidisc. They mentioned DCC has been officially pronounced dead by its maker, but the minidisc is still clinging to life in a desperate attempt to become more than a footnote in the history of audio storage devices. They say convinced that minidisc is far from a lost cause and heartened by its being a big hit in Japan, Sony is working hard to reawaken the US buying public to the advantages of minidisc. In particular, with DCC gone, Sony thinks that minidisc has a clean shot at the analog cassette. According to the Internet Archive, that DCC website that was mentioned in that letter in Stereo Review magazine remained online until 2006, although at the end of the page it says it was last updated in October 1998. And they have archives of the mailing list here if you want to go through and read all the messages that were posted on it. It's about 24 hours later now, and I have everything put back together. I know I should probably wait longer just to make sure everything is totally dry, but I'm impatient and I have nothing to lose with this, so let's see what happens. I have it connected to that little Crosley radio as an amplifier. No tape, all right. Let's try our DCC. Play. Well, it's counting. I don't know if that's just a leader or what. Let's try a fast forward. I'm not expecting this to work, but oh well. Nothing coming out of the amplifier. All right, let's try an analog tape, see if that does anything. You can hear the hiss. And again, when I turn on Dolby, the hiss goes away. So at least that part's working, but... otherwise... I'm hearing hissing and crackling. I don't know what's that coming from? Moving the ribbon cable connected to the head, and that's not making the crackling. Wiggling those boards back and forth. So basically the same thing it was doing before. So not everything can be fixed by adding water. I guess in this case the capacitors are just too far gone for that method to work. All it takes is for a couple of those capacitors to be shorted to ground, and then whatever signal's coming off the tape head gets wiped out, and that's why we're not hearing anything. But I do have some good news to report. For the first time since the year 2000, I just bought a new cassette from a major artist on a major record label. It's 21 Pilots Blurry Face on cassette. Got it on Amazon. It took a month to get here for some reason. They kept delaying the shipping. But that's their official cassette release of that album. It's by Warner Music Group. Copyright 2015. It does not mention Dolby on it anywhere, so I won't know until I play it whether or not it's actually Dolby BNR encoded. But that's nothing new, because I have a lot of cassettes from the 90s, such as this Mary Chapin Carpenter album from 1994. Which also do not mention Dolby on them anywhere, either on the liner notes or on the cassette itself. There's no Dolby logo, but it is Dolby NR encoded if you play it. So I'm wondering if that's also the case of this one. So that may be the subject of a future video. We'll have to try to get a few more new cassettes to have some more data on that. So stay tuned eventually for another cassette-related video.